I'm thankful that we have a great and awesome God that we can worship. And I pray that as you listen to the words of the song, that it was a reminder to you that the God that we serve is worthy to be praised. We recognize on this morning that some of you may be visiting with us for the first time. So if you're here for the first time online with us, can you just type in that you're here for the first time? Let us know where you're watching from, what city, what state. We want to thank God for Eugene Windstorm, who was with us last week from Murfreesboro, Tennessee, and Trinity Bailey, who was with us from Marietta, Georgia last week. So shout out to you. Thanks so much for being with us. We hope you're with us today and you invited a friend. As well, just want to take a moment to say thanks to all of you who continue to support the ministry through giving. As always, you can give utilizing our app. You can text to give. You can go to our website and give. But thank you so much for all that you do to support the work that God has given us to do. Without your giving, we can't do any of what God has called us to do. So thanks for your partnership and for your support. As well, I just want to share, it was a blessing for those of you who took time this past week to Zoom with me, to spend a little time, just to hear your story, to laugh with you, to talk with you about some important issues. I pray that those of you who participated were blessed and encouraged. Some of you got to meet new brothers and sisters in Christ who attend the church that you didn't know before. So I pray that it was a blessing to you. We're looking forward to being able to do that again sometime in the near future. Just working to keep all of us connected to help us to be the church that God has called us to be. Even though we can't come into the building physically, we thank God that we can continue to be the church. This morning, as we continue our series, Sermon 3 in the series Silent No More, I'm excited to share a book that I've been reading. Entitled The Dignity Revolution. And I actually want to read from the introduction of the book. I want to encourage you to pick up the book if you're a reader. I've been listening to it on audio, which I never do, but it's been such a blessing. It shaped my thinking. Daniel Darling, who is the author of the book, has articulated some things that I've had a conviction about, but I just couldn't put the words to it. And I appreciate him putting the words together to articulate my thoughts and my feelings. He says in the introduction, it was a weekday morning and we packed our four kids into the minivan and rambled down Route 40 towards the venerable Nashville landmark, the Grand Ole Opry. We weren't there to see one of our favorite country music artists, but a live production of Dr. Seuss, Horton Hears a Who. To be honest, while the rest of the family was excited, he says, I admit that if my wife hadn't politely asked or ordered me to take the day off work, I wouldn't have made this entertainment choice. So as we settled into our comfortable chairs at the Opry, I prepared myself to be bored. I thoroughly enjoy theater, but I had low expectations for a production designed to amuse children and by extension, weary adults. I consoled myself with a fully charged iPhone invented for these kinds of situations. My plan was to dim the brightness, read a few online articles I'd bookmarked on my browser, and re-emerge after the play. I never looked at my phone, he said. I was enraptured by the performance. I'd read the book a few times as a kid and a few more as a parent, but it wasn't until I saw Dr. Seuss's vivid morality tale on stage, under the lights, that its powerful, repeated message grabbed my heart. A person is a person, no matter how small. A person is a person, no matter how small. He says, when I heard this phrase, it was compelling. Yes, I thought every person really is a person, no matter what their usefulness to society, no matter how seemingly insignificant they are, no matter what their stature. A person's a person. What a thought for our strange and confused age, he shares. As we think about the message today, I want to focus on this idea of valuing people and valuing the human dignity that exists in every person. One writer, in talking about Darling's book, says that Darling's book is a robust apology for spirited Christian activism that prioritizes respect for human life. He suggests that a deficient understanding of human dignity harms the church's ability to live out both the Great Commission, the call to make disciples of all nations, and the Great Commandment, the call to love our neighbors. Tina Bosch Darling in his book says on page 54, the work of the gospel in bringing sinners to new life and changing sinners to be more and more like Jesus is the fullest expression of dignity for humans. As we think about the importance of life and every person deserving human dignity, I wanted us to review a few scriptures, to review concepts in what we find in our Bible from the scriptures. And I'm just gonna ask, do you agree? For example, do you agree that human beings are the height of God's creation? In Genesis 1 and 26 and Psalms 8 verses 3 through 5, the scripture says in Genesis 1, then God said, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. They will rule the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, the livestock, the whole earth, and the creatures that crawl on the earth. So God created man in his own image. He created him in the image of God. He created them male and female. God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, and every creature that crawls on the earth. And then in Psalms 8, beginning at verse 3, the psalmist says, when I observe your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you set in place, what is a human being that you remember him, a son of man that you look after him? You made him a little less, some translations say, than the angels or the Elohim, and crowned him with glory and honor. What we see in Genesis chapter 1 and in Psalm 8 is this message that God made human beings as the height of his creation. It's after he created everything else that he created male and female. And he tells male and female to have dominion over the earth, to subdue it together. He gives them the authority to subdue the earth, to exercise dominion over the earth. And then the psalmist says that God has made humanity just a little bit lower than the other created beings, than the angels that exist. Humanity is the height of God's creation. The question becomes, do you believe this? Do you agree that all human beings are created in the image and the likeness of God? Again, in Genesis 1 and 26, God says, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. They will rule the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, the livestock, the whole earth, and the creatures that crawl on the earth. God decided that he would make mankind in his image and his likeness. That means we reflect God. God has placed something in us that is like him. When people look at humanity and all of our uniqueness, we are a reflection of the goodness of God, of the grace of God, of the kindness of God, of the intelligence of God, of the creativity of God. Every human being, every person is made in the image and likeness of God. Do you agree with that statement? Do you agree that all human beings are God's knit together? God has knit us together. God knows us, that God knows every human being from conception until their last day here on earth. You see, Psalms 139, beginning at verse 13, says, for it was you who my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's. I will praise you because I have been remarkably and wondrously made. Your works are wondrous, and I know this very well. My bones were not hidden from you when I was made in secret, when I was formed in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw me when I was formless. All my days were written in your book and planned before a single one of them began. You see, the psalmist affirms the fact that God created each human being, and God created each human being to be unique, and that God knows each human being, and that God was active in the reproductive process between male and female to create the human being, that God made the human being, and he says they are wonderful, they are unique, that we are beautiful creatures and creations of God. Do you believe that God knows every human being, that God has knit every human being together, that he knit us together in the womb, and God knows our last day here on earth? Do you agree with that? And do you agree that God loves human beings so much that he sent Jesus to set us free from sin, death, and Satan? In Galatians chapter 1 and verse 3, the scripture says, "Grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to rescue us from this present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father." And then in Romans 5, beginning at verse 6, it says, "For while we were still helpless, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For rarely will someone die for a just person, though for a good person, perhaps someone might even dare to die. But God proves his own love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. How much more then, since we have now been justified by his blood, will we be saved through him from wrath? For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, then how much more, having been reconciled, will we be saved by his life? And not only that, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received this reconciliation." Do you believe that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life? That God loved every person, every human being so much that he sent his son to die for us, to get up for us, to give us victory, to have victory over sin, to have victory over death, to have victory over Satan. Do you agree with this? And do you agree that God calls those who have been reconciled to him to represent him by loving all people? Again, Mark's gospel says, "When one of the scribes approached, he heard them debating and saw that Jesus answered them well. He asked him, 'Which command is the most important of all?' And Jesus answered, 'The most important is, listen, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other command greater than these.'" Do you believe that all of us who have been reconciled to God have been commanded by God to represent him by loving human beings, by loving every person, by demonstrating their dignity through our love for them? Do you agree with those statements? You see, the statements that I just read are biblical statements, statements that are anchored in Scripture, that for most Christians on the average day, we would say, "Man, I believe that." The question becomes, how do we live out what we believe? How do we live out our belief that every person is created in the image and likeness of God? How do we live out our belief that every person has been knit together by God, uniquely made by God, is known by God from the womb until their last breath here on earth? How do we live out the truth that God loved every person so much that he sent Jesus to die for them? And how do we live out the truth that those of us who have been reconciled to God through Christ Jesus have the responsibility, the privilege to love our neighbors in very tangible ways? How do we live that out when it comes to issues of life? How do we take a stand? How do we affirm those truth statements when we deal with everyday issues that are talked about in our society? For example, how do we apply those truths when it comes to the discussion of abortion? You, since the Bible is clear about God's hand in the reproduction process and his knowledge of us from the beginning, from the womb, his understanding of when we will take our last breath, since God is a part of the conception process and he shapes us and knits us together, he makes us uniquely and we are wonderfully made by him, I therefore must conclude that a person is a person in the womb. And since a person is a person in the womb, then just as it is wrong to take the life of a person outside of the womb, I conclude that it is wrong to take the life of a person inside the womb. I'm mindful of the fact that there are varying circumstances with this issue. But my basic point is that a person is a person inside the womb, and a person is a person outside of the womb. And please hear my heart. I'm in no position to stand and condemn anyone who has made the choice to seek an abortion. I trust that the same grace that God has given me for my sins will be extended to them for their sin. I trust that the same forgiveness that God has given me for the sins that I commit, God will also give to them for their sin. Because God is a gracious God and God is a forgiving God, I cannot stand in a place of condemnation. I trust that the grace of God is available to all of us who are sinners who stand before our holy God. I am pro-life because the Bible is pro-life. I am thankful, however, for a statement that's made in Daniel Darling's book. He says, be pro-life after birth as much as we are pro-life before the birth. I'm thankful for that statement because that statement captured my heart, oftentimes my frustration with the behavior of people who would stand for pro-life and fight to protect life in the womb, but seemingly not take the same stand for life outside of the womb. So I applaud the Women's Pregnancy Center here in town for their work in our community, demonstrating the same commitment to life after birth as they do to life before birth. I appreciate them connecting with mothers and fathers, pregnant women who are about to give birth and soon to be fathers, and connecting them with mentors to help them understand parenthood and what it means to be a mother and what it means to be a father. I am thankful for their work, and I'm thankful for some of our men who have partnered with them and served as mentors to many of the young men on what it means to be a father. I celebrate the many members of our church who have opened up their homes and their lives by becoming foster parents and adoptive parents because they believe in the importance of life after birth, just as they value the importance of life before birth. You see, this is what I believe the Bible communicates about what it means to be pro-life, that pro-life means that all life, life in the womb and life outside the womb, is valuable in the eyesight of God and deserving of the dignity that God has bestowed upon them. Abortion is one issue, but how do we apply these truths when we encounter those who are disabled or differently able? I thank God for Johnny Erickson Tata. She says, all life is created in the image of God and worth our greatest efforts to preserve and protect, and He alone is the one who should order the length of our days. You see, since we believe that God knows all of our days and God has created everyone and everyone is uniquely and wonderfully made, then we celebrate the life, even if they are disabled or differently able. We trust and believe that God has a plan and God has a purpose and God has given them as a gift to our society, to our culture, to our world. So we value, we encourage, we embrace, we love, we serve, and we see the hand of God in every individual who may be disabled or differently able. How do we apply these truths to those who are senior citizens or have had their capacity for some reason diminished? Oftentimes, when we think about senior citizens as they age, we start to look down upon them as their ability to walk or care for themselves may be diminished, or those who are not able to provide care for themselves, those who are no longer able to feed themselves. Often as a society, we tuck them away. We hide them, we put them away in different places and facilities, and we no longer demonstrate care for them or love for them or concern for them. But if we truly believe that every person deserves the dignity that God has bestowed upon them, then shouldn't we demonstrate love and care and concern for them just as we do everyone else? You see, our conviction that God has made every person in His image and His likeness doesn't change based on age, and it doesn't change based on capacity. It doesn't change based on society's perception of a person's usefulness to the society. No, God has bestowed honor and dignity upon them because they have been created in His image and His likeness. Chi Lee from Singapore says this, and I appreciate the statement: value and dignity of human life is grounded in the fact that God is the giver of life. Human life doesn't fluctuate with the level of perceived usefulness of a person to society or the degree of suffering they are experiencing, because human worth is grounded in the image of God. A child, differently abled person, or elderly person is no less the image of God than anyone else. Finally, how do we apply these truths to those who have committed crimes or been incarcerated? Do we believe, because the scripture teaches that every person who is a person is created in the image and the likeness of God, that every person deserves human dignity? And if so, do we apply that same belief to those who have been incarcerated, to those who may have committed crimes against society? If we hold true to the teachings of Scripture, they are image bearers of God. They are people who deserve human dignity because they are made in the image and the likeness of God. And how do we demonstrate as a society the fact that we value them as individuals, the fact that they are still image bearers, even though they have committed crimes against society? How do we continue to demonstrate love for them and care for them and concern for them? If we truly believe what the scripture teaches, then at no point should we stop demonstrating concern to people just because they are incarcerated. You see, I believe that every person is created in the image and the likeness of God. And this is true regardless of their behavior. It's true regardless of their race. It's true regardless of their beliefs. It's true regardless of their economic status. It's true regardless of their capacity. And it's true regardless of societal perception of their youthfulness. Finally, Daniel Darling says on page 212 in his book, "For every argument we make online or in the office of a public official, there are hundreds of interactions in our daily lives that test whether we really think every person is made in God's image. Human dignity is more than a platform. It is a way of life." And for those of us who are followers of Jesus Christ, I pray that we would believe the teachings of Scripture and we would follow the example of Jesus Christ, our Savior. You see, when Jesus touched the lepers, He was reminding the people of His day that they were deserving of human dignity. When He allowed the woman with the issue of blood to touch His hem of the garment, He was demonstrating to the people of that day that even though they perceived her as unclean, she was a person of human dignity. When He blessed the children, when the disciples were trying to stop them from bringing children to Him because of the value that they placed on children, they didn't value them in the same way they did adults. Jesus said, "No, allow them to come to Me." He was recognizing their human dignity. When He touched the man with the deformed hand, He was recognizing his human dignity. And just as Jesus recognized the God-given dignity to every person who is created in the image and likeness of God, we likewise, as followers of Jesus, should follow His example in recognizing the God-given dignity that is given to every person. Because a person is a person, no matter how small. We are all significant in the eyesight of God. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word today to remind us of the dignity that you have given to every person. Thank you that you value every person, that you've created every person in your image and your likeness. And because you've created them in your image and your likeness, then we should give them the dignity that they deserve. Help us as the body of Christ to value life inside the womb and also to value life outside the womb, to value life no matter how old a person may become, to value life whether a person is able to continue to function in society, to do for themselves, or they have diminished capacity, to value life no matter where we see life, to see your hand, your grace, your beauty, and your love in the eyes and the interactions with every individual that we may encounter. Bless that we would value lives because you value lives. Thank you for loving people so much that you would send your son to die for us, to rise for us, and to live for us. Help us now to follow his example. Hear our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.